This week on WealthTrack, a dynamic duo of super value investors, Wally Weitz of the Weitz Funds and Tom Russo of Gardner, Russo & Gardner, search high and low for extraordinary bargains, but find them in very different places. Two great value investors next on Consuelo Mack WealthTrack.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fair Home Foundation. Hello and welcome to this edition of WealthTrack. I'm Consuelo Mack. This week for our first show of the new year, we have a WealthTrack exclusive with two outstanding value investors together on television for the first time, although they are good friends and have known each other for many years. Wallace Weitz is the founder, president, and portfolio manager of the Weitz Funds, where he started the flagship Weitz Partners Value Fund as a private partnership 30 years ago. Since its 1983 launch, this Morningstar favorite has racked up market and category-beating returns. Weitz now co-manages Partners Value, Weitz Value Fund, and Hickory Fund, but is the sole manager of the Partners 3 Opportunity Fund. Although his funds tend to have low turnover rates, Weitz is an active manager. He will go through periods where the values in the market are so compelling to him that he becomes fully invested. Other times when he sees limited opportunities, he will trim positions and raise large amounts of cash. Right now, he is carrying about 30% in cash and Partners Value. Tom Russo is a partner in the investment advisory firm Gardner, Russo & Gardner, where he has run the Sempervic Partners Fund for nearly a quarter of a century. Since Sempervic's 1990 launch, it has delivered market-beating returns. Russo, who also has very low turnover in his funds, tends to stay fully invested and specializes in holding global, brand-name companies, mostly based overseas and many family-controlled. Although their view of the values in the market are very different, as are most of their holdings, they have one big thing in common. Berkshire Hathaway is one of the largest holdings in each of their portfolios, and they are huge fans of Warren Buffett. Before we discuss those similarities, I asked them about where they diverge, how difficult it is to find value in the current market.
Very difficult. We look at companies one at a time and measure the business value and want to buy at a deep discount to that, and that doesn't exist in this world. We found two or three new companies in the fourth quarter, so it's not zero, but we're not enthusiastic about the price we're paying. So we're taking little positions and hoping the market will go down.
And 30% in cash?
30% plus or minus in the stock funds
right.
In cash, yeah.
So, Tom, but you, on the other hand, a value investor, are pretty fully invested.
Yeah.
But that's all the time, right?
It is. I tend to be fully invested in so far as my allocation for most of my investors is just for a small portion of their funds with the idea towards accessing the kinds of businesses that I focus on, which have a very long horizon. They're global businesses that are investing against the future for quite a long time. And as such, for example, one of the things you have to wrestle with is that with upfront investing that's quite considerable, the PE ratios for those businesses are often overstated because the earnings component of that ratio is burdened by the investment spending that takes place when you're building out the network for a Nestle or a Heineken around the world.
But I think Tom and I both think about business value versus price, not statistically cheap PE or price to book and that sort of thing. We're thinking about discount to the value to a business person and a company that actually grows, that actually has stability and a great 10 or 15 year runway is worth a lot more than some very ordinary cyclical company that may have a low price earnings ratio. So
right.
We would agree on that.
Yes.
And if you looked at our portfolio today compared to 10 years ago, you would find our average PE much higher and the quality of our companies much higher.
But the difference is that you do this, you do an analysis of the business value versus the price, right?
Right. We measure not only the price to value of every individual stock, but we look at the weighted average price to value of the whole portfolio. And so in March of 2009, our weighted average price to value was like in the 40% range. Today it's like close to 90%. And that doesn't mean it's going to go down. It just means that it probably will go down, but temporarily. But the point is the odds of doing very well from a 90% is a lot lower than the likelihood of doing well from 40%, if we've measured it right.
Right.
And so we're just trying to play the odds and put the odds in the investor's favor. And even though we're 30% in cash, we are 70% invested, and we're invested in Berkshire's and TransDimes and Liberty Globals and companies. There's some overlap with Tom, but the conceptual overlap is very considerable.
So what changes are you making in your portfolio based on what's been happening in the market?
There are rebalancing portfolio changes that take place regularly. Mm-hmm. And that often occurs in part because some position has moved up to a higher percentage weight than it probably warrants in light of the advance in its share price and the resulting discount to its intrinsic value. So you have that movement up, and it's often happening at the same time as other businesses for reasons that might not bear merit have gone down in value. And so their discount from their intrinsic value deepens. And so on the balance, that rebalancing adds value, I think, from moving from the overweight, less undervalued, to the less weighted, more undervalued. And one thing I would say is the amazing thing about the 40% discount scenario that Wally referred to in March of 2009, the issue was you had to get up from under the table to see those values, because in March of 2009, it was a really scary time.
Right, the Wall Street was falling apart.
It was extremely important at that time that you just kept your investors invested.
Right.
Because their instincts were to just pull out of the market. And with a full investment sort of bias, I go through the same type of swings that Wally does. But at some point, I think a value to the investor is just to know that the businesses have an embedded direction, and the market can swing as it does, and we can add some value through the rebalancing. But at the end of the day, it's better to own great businesses than not.
It was good to have cash in March of 2009.
Yes. Right.
And we couldn't wait to get it invested, and it really helped the rebound off the bottom. And I think it's times like that sort of reinforce the idea for me of being comfortable with high cash positions when things are expensive, because it seems that the opportunity cost of the cash, I don't worry about it earning zero. Sometimes zero is the best there's going to be.
Better than losing it,
But having cash in times of distress is important. And that's really what investors pay us for, whether they realize it or not. It's so that we will be investing or staying invested at bottoms and not letting them panic and shoot themselves in the foot.
Right.
All out of the market is a risky position, even though it may be driven by a fear of risk. Being all out of the market is itself a risky position, and that's right. What we try to balance back and forth with the percentage weight. The notion of having cash and the value of having cash can also surface within the companies.
Absolutely.
So Nestle in 2011, second half of 2011, had a terrific opportunity to make three acquisitions that built their franchise substantially stronger in China. Most of the world had fled China in the second half of 2011. Chinese stocks had collapsed, and the market wasn't rewarding anybody for being anywhere close to China, much like today. But Nestle went into that market and bought a beverage company, bought the largest confectionery company, and bought a Wyeth's infant formula business, exactly because they could at compelling prices. And then on top of that, they might go in and buy back some stock during a downturn. If they have cash and they have a long-term mindedness, they will build more value for us during those sharp downturns than not.
So. And Berkshire in March.
So let's talk about Berkshire, because we're talking about some differences and similarities. But the two of you, your largest holdings, or one of your largest holdings, is Berkshire. So talk about Berkshire, Wally.
Well, Berkshire is a collection of businesses that Warren's put together over 50-plus years that generate excess cash. They send a billion or two home to Omaha every month for him to reinvest. And he does let cash pile up
right.
at times. And so when we got into the financial crisis and Goldman needed, they needed money badly on that Sunday afternoon, he was able to get fabulous terms, and the same for GE and the same for Bank of America. But Warren, you know, there's a people, there are plenty of people who have high IQs or who are driven or are great business minds or a lot of these other characteristics. Warren has them all. And what's great about Berkshire, from my point of view, is it will be a totally different company if you were to just look at it every 10 years. But the organization of it and what he's doing with the cash flow will be consistent. And so you can close your eyes. And I think the last two or three, and maybe every time I've been on your show, you said, well, what's one stock? And I've said, well, Berkshire Hathaway, because you can leave it alone and trust Warren to reinvent it as needed and continuously over time and be totally disciplined. There's criticism in some paper recently about, you know, Warren's investment record isn't so great because he uses leverage, because he has $75 billion of float, which is like an interest-free loan for him. But there's a lot of people who have access to leverage and have blown themselves up in much shorter period than 50 years. And so for him to be able to keep buying the stocks that look kind of boring to people on the outside, the Cokes and the American Expresses and so on, and do it for 50 years and compound at 20%+ and do it in a very tax efficient way for the investors, it's...
extraordinary. So you were just telling me that if you look at what Warren Buffett's doing, his most recent acquisitions, the big ones, ExxonMobil.
Yeah. I think, you know, Warren...
IBM. Tell me about your analysis of the IBM and ExxonMobil.
I've just been struck by how obvious and how plain and how straightforward those investments are and how enormously dull they are and how boring. And in a marketplace that's full with stories, to see where Warren puts the capital, and it's completely ignored. Often, if we have an interview in a forum like this, people say, why on earth would you talk in a forum like this? Because after all, won't people copy you? Well, Warren's always said that, you know, he'll do things publicly, he'll talk about it publicly, and it's just too dull for most people. And these are two stocks that are just too dull. But there's absolutely no reason, if properly harnessed, that they couldn't clearly deliver a double. In which case, Warren will have added another $17 billion in value to his shareholders.
Well, and part of the purchase price comes from zero or negative cost interest-free, or, you know, loan, indefinite length loan from the float.
Right, from his cash.
So even if it, you know, even if it only does 10% a year, the leverage makes it 15, or, you know, it's...
And there's something,
but they have to last.
Yes.
And they have to survive.
Yep.
And they have to not disappear overnight. Yep. And those two companies, I think he believes, have that. You start with that.
But let's get off Warren, because I feel like so he's a one-off.
Yeah.
But you two invest in companies for long term, and you told me, Tom, that for instance, Heineken.
Yes.
Is, because I said, so you're still owning Heineken, and you said no, but it's a totally different company than it was 10 years ago. So tell me about the kinds of management that you look for that aren't just Warren Buffett.
I think the lesson that's most powerful from Berkshire to answer your question is companies have to have the capacity to suffer when they want to expand. And so we look for businesses that have, first of all, the opportunity to expand, the capacity to reinvest that arises from the history of the accident of history in many instances. Nestle happens to be in 190 countries around the world, 75 active businesses around the world, because they came from a small Swiss country base and they grew organically. Heineken grew around the world because there were only 13 million Dutch drinkers of Heineken beer. And even though Heineken beer in Holland
is... They over-index, though.
Oh, yeah. ...is so much more than a breakfast drink, as they call it. At some point, there are only that many hours a day. They had to look elsewhere. And with them traveled their brands.
But that's also a family-controlled business, Heineken,
absolutely.
Whereas Nestle is not. But that's another thing that you two look for in this, kind of the initial screen is management that you can trust. So tell me about the screen of management, why management is so important.
Well, Tom talks about the ability to suffer, and he's talking often about families that have multi-generations, that they're completely committed to the thing and committed for the next generation. we're looking for the same sort of thing in a different form. We want the Buffetts, the John Malones, the
Liberty Media. You've invested with Malone for a long time.
People like the guy who runs TransDigm. It's all about the company for him and doing a great job. And so they're not only able to execute well, they're smart about reallocating the capital they generate, and they can stop, they just avoid listening to Wall Street. There's a great book that was out in the last year or so called The Outsiders, and by Thorndike, and he profiles, 10 different managers, and it's Henry Singleton, and it's Buffett, and it's, companies who ignore Wall Street and do what they think is right for the company. Now, if you ignore Wall Street and do what's wrong for the company, that doesn't do any good.
But how can you? Who can do that now besides a Warren Buffett and a John Malone and
well a John Malone has super voting stock.
I mean, who can survive to get to that?
I think that's where you get the benefit from family controlled companies. I mean, I have probably 60% of the companies I have in the portfolio are still run by the founding families. They may have obviously professionals actually executing, but the perspective and the capacity to sustain a long-term investment is given the management because of the strength of the controlled vote. Even yesterday, there was a news that Discover Network was looking at acquiring Home and Garden TV Networks, called the Scripps Network. But that business didn't exist 12 years ago. It came out of the Scripps company on the vision of a couple of managers, and they put together resources from television and broadcast and the newspaper business, and they came up with a proposal, and the family backed it and said, "We will back you to the tune of $150 million of operating losses over the 4 or 5 years to invest in
that's
the business."
That's unusual.
In today's world, particularly so, because around every corner lurks an activist. And if an activist knew that Scripps was in the midst of doing an investment for the future and came knocking on the door and said, "We demand results today," they would most likely, if the company didn't have control share, they would trigger the divestiture or the reduction of that effort, which would be at the long-term harm of investors. So we have Wall Street that always demands something each quarter, and then now this new force of activism that comes along and in the midst of something that might be good long-term, shakes the tree to get current numbers back a little bit higher and then declare victory. And it may come at a horrible cost to the business, and that's where the family control to assure them sort of a go-away pill when somebody comes along and asks for immediate results allows them to focus on the long-term. And that makes a big difference.
The super voting stock is more common in media land, and that really helps. And Malone—that's how Malone keeps people at bay for Liberty companies. That can work both ways. We owned TDS, Telephone Data Systems, for 8 or 10 years, and it was just a horrible experience because it was a family-run business. They passed up multiple really good opportunities, and we finally gave up and went away. So it's not it's not perfect, but you need the strength of character and it doesn't hurt to have the voting control.
But also, activist investors can work in your favor, right?
Well, they can work in our favor
as a shareholder.
As a shareholder, yeah. And there's some, I mean, activist is a, it's applied to a lot of people. And there's some loud, obnoxious activists that I really don't welcome into our companies. But on the other hand, somebody like Value Act, Jeff Ubben, I think has been very helpful to a lot of companies, and we're glad when he comes into one we already own, and when he buys a new one, we take a harder look at it. He came in and got involved in Valiant Pharmaceutical.
Mm-hmm. Which has been a very successful holding
enormous.
For you.
It's been a terrific stock for us the last year and a half. Now, there's things to be scared about there, too, but he brought in a new CEO that had a totally different business model and approach, and focused on the better part or the safer part of pharma land, and got out of the things that were more dangerous that had patent cliffs and with took a lot of R&D and that had reimbursement issues. Focused on others, and he's made a series of acquisitions and made huge cost cuts, and that can go too far. I mean, Teledyne maybe took it too far in the 80s, but it's been a very successful thing. And it was Value Act that really triggered that change and built up the comp system. You know, Charlie Munger always talks about the incentives being the most important part of any equation, and having the right comp for the senior leadership is really important.
So not stock options necessarily,
right?
While you're there,
right? They pay their own money. They buy stock with their own money, and they stand to make an enormous score at the end, but only after 5 or 10 or 15 years, and at much higher stock prices. Mm-hmm. So the incentives need to be right.
So I have about 5 minutes left in this conversation. I can't believe it. It's gotten way too quickly. Yeah. So let me at least get the one investments out. So if there were one investment that you wanted to put in somebody's long-term diversified portfolio, Tom, what would it be?
You know, I have so many that I'd like to put in.
I know you do.
Same holdings that I have across the board. But I guess at this moment, it might be Heineken. And it might be Heineken Holding Company. And the holding company gives us a little bit of an extra return kicker because it's the vehicle through which the family, the Carvalho family, controls the company, but it trades at a perennial discount to the operating company's share. So we buy it at a discount. It's delivered to us investors because of the vision and control of Charlene and Michelle Carvalho, the Heineken heirs, a vastly expanded universe in which they can invest going forward. So they were 20% exposed to developing emerging markets 10 years ago. They're 70% exposed to developing emerging markets today. That includes FEMSA in Mexico, Asia Pacific, India. They have an involvement in India. All this comes...
A lot of beer companies.
It's all beer.
All
in
beer.
This case, it is a beer business. Mm-hmm. It's not like some Diageo, which has beer and also spirits. Now, I have equally large holding in SAB Miller, equally large holding in Anheuser-Busch InBev. It's just that in this case, for some reason, right now, Heineken's valuation is much lower than the rest, and that's why, of the group, I would say that would be the one. Very clear stewardship from the family, and a management that doesn't have to look over its shoulder when they act for fear of having an activist come along.
Right, 3G must have their eye on them.
I think, you know, there's all sorts of rumors about global consolidation in the industry and the rest. But at the valuation levels, plus the opportunity to redeploy capital based on the steps that they've taken over the past 5 years, I think that's probably a good investment.
Now it's Wally's turn. What investment?
I'd slide Berkshire in as a bonus pick
because I've already done it. Class B, which is the cheaper one. You own Class A, Tom Russo.
I've done it three times before.
Yep.
So I try to think of another one where you have management you can trust to reinvent the company as needed, and the extreme case of that would be one of the Liberties, and I would pick Liberty Media, LMCA as the symbol. It's now, at the moment, about $100 and some a share worth of SiriusXM radio, which they got for zero cost.
Wow.
And another $35 or so of Charter Communications, which they are now using to try to go after Time Warner. You have John Malone. You also have another $10 or so of other public companies, another $10 of private companies. But you have a pool of really good assets in the hands of an active, smart, good manager. So it will look totally different 5 years from now. It'll look totally different 10 years from now. But if somebody had to put something away,
right?
What's the valuation? What is the market price?
The market price is about 100. It's a high 100, 145, 150. Our valuation really is 160 or 65. So it's not cheap. Nothing is cheap. Nobody should buy anything because we mentioned it today.
Right.
But if you had to own some, I'm going to be happy to own that 5 years and 10 years from now.
We'll have to leave it there, unfortunately. But that's no. So I could see Tom thinking about Liberty right now.
Yeah.
Wally Weitz, thanks so much for coming in and seeing
Thank
us
you.
From Omaha. We really appreciate it. And from Pennsylvania, Tom Russo, thank you so much for joining us on WealthTrack again. Great to have you two here.
Thank you very much.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is make sure you have some boring investments in your portfolio. Tom Russo and Wally Weitz just described Warren Buffett's habit of buying quote-unquote dull companies such as IBM and ExxonMobil that other investors aren't interested in. Purchased at the right price, what these so-called boring companies can offer is a history of survival, adaptability, and financial heft, which gives them the ability to invest when they need to, buy back stock, and pay out dividends. Over the long term, these qualities can really pay off. Well, next week, we have our annual exclusive New Year Outlook with ISI Group's Ed Hyman, the street's number one ranked economist for more than 30 years running. And this year, Ed will be joined by Legg Mason's legendary great investor, Bill Miller, who is back at the top of his game. The first of our two-part series with them starts next week. In the meantime, please visit our website, WealthTrack.com, for more of our interview with Wally Weitz and Tom Russo in our extra feature, and connect with us on Facebook and Twitter. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sales, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Wintergreen, your home for global value. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairhome Foundation.